Happy fall, everyone, and welcome back to our Sky Tonight program. My name is Seth Mayo. I'm the curator of astronomy for the Lohmann Planetarium. And for those who are new to this program, this is our weekly Sky Tonight video series that we've been doing for the past year and a half, where we highlight the celestial events and celestial objects you can find on a given week or even through the month as well. And it also allows us to tie in spaceflight events and other events in the sky that tell us more about the universe. And so we thank those who have been following us along the way, and thank you for tuning in for this episode. So for this week, we are covering the dates of September 27th through October 3rd of 2021. We're gonna first talk about the morning sky and all the winter constellations you can find there right now. We'll then move to where the moon is and how it's moving through those stars in the early morning. And we'll finish things off with a discussion about what's coming up for the month of October. So let's get to it. As we've mentioned in previous episodes, we never want to forget those early morning risers that take a look at the night sky. And if you're out just before sunrise, maybe around the 6, even 6:30 time frame, and you're looking kind of towards the south, even southeast, you have a really great view of stars that you typically find in the wintertime, but are now really high up in the early morning. And so it's always great to kind of look out for these because it does kind of signal the next season that is coming up. And one constellation that really stands out, and the one that I always kind of feature when I talk about winter constellations, is that of Orion the Hunter. And we can find Orion pretty high in the sky. And one thing with Orion, if you know him already, which I'm sure many of you already do, is you gotta find his belt first. Those three stars that line up in a row, there is Orion's belt right there. And once you find the belt, everything else falls into place. We have his shoulder stars with his right shoulder named Betelgeuse right here. And his left foot down here, this is called Rigel. And so those two stars are different colors, very stark difference between them. And these are the feet stars actually down here. So I'll turn on the shape of Orion the Hunter that we see there. And if you find Orion, I always like to use his belt to point to either side of him to find other winter objects. So his belt to the right, like this, in this direction here, will lead you to a group of stars that look like a letter V in the sky. That V is the nose of Taurus the Bull. And if you want the rest of Taurus, you look above the V. If you extend the V out a little bit, you'll find two stars of kind of average brightness. Those are the horns, or the tips of the horns of Taurus the Bull. And if you move over here to the right side of the V, a little farther towards the west, you might find a little grouping of stars known as the Pleiades star cluster. Taurus the Bull is a great constellation, and you can find it there, not far from Orion. If we go back to Orion's belt, we can use his belt to point to the left, or really right now to the southeast, to point to the brightest star in the night sky, which is called Sirius. And Sirius is part of the dog known as Canis Major. So if you are in a dark enough spot, you can really see a lot of stars that do kind of look like a dog. You can find the head of a dog here. Sometimes the star Sirius is part of the head, or maybe part of the jewel of the collar around the neck of the dog if you use a bit more imagination. And sometimes you'll find a body, a tail, and some legs here. So it kind of works as a small dog, and it's one of Orion's hunting dogs from Greek mythology. There's another dog you probably know in this area if you know the night sky well. If we look kind of north of Sirius, you'll find two stars here. One that's a little brighter than the other. This is called Procyon. And Procyon, this brighter one, is part of the small dog known as Canis Minor. It's also known as Procyon as well, the name of the dog. And so this is the small dog right here. So this is another one of Orion's hunting dogs from Greek mythology. As we continue on here for these winter stars, just above Orion's club, because Orion is holding a club above him. Those are some dimmer stars, but in a dark enough location, you might see them. You may find the stars of Gemini, the Gemini twins right here. So we have the two heads of the twins here. This is Pollux, and then this one's Castor. And then you can see the bodies that just turned on as well. And in Stellarium, they do kind of look like two stick figure shapes sort of holding hands in the sky. So that's kind of nice too. These are famous sailors. They are part of Jason's Argonauts from those ancient stories. And another group of stars that may not be as famous, but are noticeable in the winter sky, is also in this area too. And what's featured as the brightest star in the constellation is this one right here called Capella. Capella is a very, very bright star. And it's part of a group of stars that look like this kind of very loose looking sort of oval or maybe circle shape. It's not perfect, but it kind of has that appearance, and I'm gonna draw it for you right there. And this looks nothing like what the constellation's supposed to be. This is called Auriga the Charioteer. And so that one is nice as well, especially for the bright star of Capella that you find there. So these winter stars that many of you may already know are featured very high in the morning if you're getting up, or if you're watching the sun rise towards the east. Turning on the pictures kind of gives you a better sense of the mythology, the imagination behind these constellations that signal winter is coming for the northern hemisphere. Now, along with those early morning winter constellations that you can find, the moon will also be in this area for this week if you're out early before sunrise. And so we start off with actually a waning gibbous moon, when the moon is technically more than half full, embedded in those winter stars that you find right there. But we'll turn those off right now. And as we continue on through the week, we'll watch where the moon moves through. So let's do that now. We're starting with, this is Tuesday morning here. And as we move through these subsequent mornings, we'll watch that the moon will actually head to the eastern horizon. So we'll head over to the 29th, and technically the 29th, the moon is half full, or what we call a last quarter phase, as it continues to wane across the sky. And as we get to last quarter phase here and the morning after, we'll find the moon get really, really close to the star here. I mentioned part of the Gemini twins of Pollux, one of the heads of Gemini that we can find there. And then we can continue on from there, watching the moon continue to descend in the eastern sky. So let's go to October 1st, and then 2nd, and then by Sunday, October 3rd, is when you find a very thin crescent moon here. And the moon will be embedded inside the constellation of Leo the Lion. And you'll find a hook for the head of Leo here. So the moon will have descended through that hook shape inside of Leo the Lion. And I always say, I love a crescent moon. It just looks really, really nice. And sometimes when the moon is in this phase, you may even see a little bit of the night side of the moon lit up just a tad bit. You can kind of see that in stellarium right here. And that is something called Earth shine. That's actually from Earth's reflection, reflecting light from the sun back to the moon and even lighting up the night side of the moon that we find here, and it makes it glow just a little bit. So it's kind of neat to know that the Earth's reflection is actually making the moon look a little bit brighter on the darker night side right now for a phase like this. So it makes it really, really nice as you watch the moon descend closer to the eastern horizon, eventually having a new moon the following week. As we look ahead for the month of October, let's take a look at some of the celestial events that are going on that are quite interesting. So a date to take note, at least for the phase of the moon, is October 6th. And that's when we have a new moon phase, when the far side of the moon is lit by the sun, which means the side we normally see is in shadow, which means you don't see the moon at all. So even though you can't see the moon at all, what that does provide us with is a better chance of a darker sky. And if you're out, especially this time of year when we're not far from the summer, the Milky Way is well placed in the sky. So if the moon is not out and you go to a darker location, when the moon is new, especially around October 6th, that is a great time to try to view the Milky Way, which arcs across the entire sky still at this time of year in the evening. And it allows you to see other dim objects as well. Maybe a nebula, a galaxy, a star cluster. All of those things become a little easier to see when you have a moonless night, especially on a new moon happening on October 6th. On the evening of Friday, October 8th, we have the peak of the annual Draconids meteor shower. And the Draconids are a lesser known meteor shower that doesn't last for very long and doesn't have a high meteors per hour rate, maybe about 10 meteors per hour that you can find from this particular meteor shower. But it's still one to look out for. And the moon won't be a large phase. You can actually see it to the left here, a very thin crescent phase here. So it may give you a better opportunity to see the Draconids. And the Draconids are named after the constellation called Draco the Dragon, this long meandering constellation in the northern part of our sky that's supposed to represent a dragon that you find here. So the Draconids' radiant point, where you can see or at least trace back to where the meteors shoot from, that radiant point is near the head of this very large dragon constellation in the sky. And if we look not far away is the star Vega. So Vega can kind of help you to figure out where that radiant point is. And if you know Vega, that is part of the famous summer triangle asterism here. So Vega is a very, very bright star that you can find not far away from the radiant point or the head of Draco the dragon. And again, this is not one of the most active meteor showers, and most likely the best time to view this meteor shower is in the evening of the 8th, because the peak of it actually happens in the afternoon of that day. And so that evening would be good, or even the following morning on October 9th, because a lot of times mornings are really good for meteor showers, when Earth would be turned into the stream of the meteors that emanate from the comet that produced this particular meteor shower. On Wednesday, October 20th, we have a full moon. So we see the entire disk of the moon as seen from Earth, and when we see the moon all night long. And the full moon, usually after a harvest moon, which happened last month, is called a hunter's moon. And that's probably because a lot of folks were hunting at this time of year, especially before winter started, and many animals were plump and ready to bear down for the winter. And so hunting was the best at this time of the year. So we can look forward to a very large moon that night on October 20th. Just the following morning, on Thursday, October 21st, we have the peak of the annual Orionid meteor shower. The Orionids are named after the famous constellation we talked about earlier, and that of course is Orion the Hunter here. And the Orionid's radiant point is near the club of this mighty hunter from Greek mythology. And this meteor shower typically produces about 10 to 20 meteors per hour. So again, not one of the highest meteor rates compared to other showers, but still a possibility to see them. The one tough thing about this opportunity is that the moon is pretty much near full, and that moon will provide a lot of light pollution in the sky. So it may make it very difficult to see the meteors for the Orionids. But if you are deciding to try it out, the morning of the 21st before dawn. And this particular one definitely is an early morning type of meteor shower, when again the Earth will be pointed into the stream of meteors coming from the comet that produces this particular meteor shower. And so it's usually best in the early mornings around that date. Doesn't have to be just on the 21st, but that is technically the peak at that time. So good luck finding some of the Orionids. On the morning of October 25th, we have Mercury at what's called greatest western elongation. And that's when Mercury is farthest west of the sun in the early morning sky, which means it's highest in the morning. That tiny little planet that circles the sun very, very quickly. And we mentioned a handful of episodes ago that since Mercury moves so quickly, it's named after the Roman messenger god, the one who traveled very fast. And so you find it moves between these greatest heights above the sun pretty rapidly throughout the year. So we have a better chance for the early morning viewing of Mercury, this tiny little planet that never strays too far from the sun, but it's still kind of neat to find it if you are looking in the right location. And rounding out the month on October 29th, we can go over to the evening sky towards the west and southwest, where we're gonna find the brightest planet that you can find from Earth, and that is the planet Venus. And Venus will also make its highest approach above the sun, and this is called greatest eastern elongation. So it's greatest east of the sun right now, which means it's highest in our evening sky, which will make it easier to spot and for longer as well. But it is so, so bright, so it's hard to miss if you're looking anywhere near the west and southwest in the evening, right around sunset. So we have a nice view of that at the end of the month. So for stars, constellations, and planets that we can generally find for the month of October, where we can start with is in the west and southwest, where, as I just mentioned, Venus is still visible in the sky and reaching its highest point by the end of the month. So that's nice to have the brightest planet that you can see from Earth in a pretty decent spot after sunset. And if you're looking in that area not far from Venus, you can actually see the heart star of Scorpius beginning to set. Right here, that's a star called Antares. And Scorpius the Scorpion is right there connected to that star. There you can find the S shape also setting, so it is getting pretty difficult to see this summertime constellation. Now if we look above the tail and stinger of Scorpius, we can also see, getting kind of low in the southwest, are the stars of Sagittarius, which look like a teapot that we find right here that I am circling. I'll turn on Sagittarius. Again, another leftover summer constellation that's getting a little lower in the sky, but we have a little more time to see this grouping of stars. Now, as we continue kind of moving through this area, what we'll do now is we will move past Sagittarius and head over to these two planets that are still great to find, really high up, easy to spot, and they're fairly bright. And this is the planet Saturn that we can find here, the planet with beautiful rings. And then not far behind it is the planet Jupiter, the largest planet in our solar system. So that's going to be nice to have those two planets still fairly high in the sky towards the south through this month as well. Now, as we continue to look around the sky here, let's look almost straight up right when it gets dark this month, and we still have a great view of that summer triangle, that great asterism made by these three stars that we find in the summer, but also for most of the fall as well. Of course, we can find the constellations of Cygnus the Swan here that looks kind of like a cross. We have the brightest star in the triangle, Vega, part of the tiny constellation of Lyra the Harp, the little parallelogram. And we have the third star here. This is Altair, part of Aquila the Eagle. So those will still be high up for the entire month of October. And of course, we're in the fall, so we definitely have to mention some fall constellations that are out that are nice to look at. So if we head over to the east, you don't have to stay up too late to now see some really nice constellations here. So if we look directly east, you'll find this big square in the sky. And we'll talk more about this constellation later. This square is actually an asterism called the Great Square, but it's part of the famous constellation known as Pegasus, the Winged Horse. There's the head, the legs, and the body of Pegasus. And not far from Pegasus, we have some other fall constellations as well, a little bit more to the northeast, where we'll find, connected to Pegasus, the stars of Andromeda the Princess that we find there, and of course the Andromeda Galaxy inside of her. And not far from her is a very prominent northern hemisphere grouping of stars that looks like a letter W, and that is of Cassiopeia. And so Cassiopeia is the queen, she's the mother of Andromeda, and she is getting pretty high in the sky, so you may have already noticed those stars. And underneath those two characters, you'll find the stars of the famous warrior and hero known as Perseus, who saves Andromeda from a sea monster. So these fall constellations are pretty high in the east and northeast, a lot easier to see, of course, at this time of the year here in October, among the other objects and some leftover summer constellations and those planets that are still really nice as well. Well, that's it for another edition of our Sky Tonight program. Thank you very much for tuning in. And if you're in the area in Daytona Beach, please stop by the Museum of Arts and Sciences and the Lohman Planetarium. We are running shows daily. So if you want any more information about our programs, please check online on our website. So with that, I say hope to see you back here again. And of course, happy stargazing.